In 1869, Napoleon III challenged scientists in France to develop a cheap and long-lasting alternative to butter to feed his armies and the lower classes. French chemist Hippolyte Méger-Maurier rose to the challenge and created oleomargarine through a process very similar to the modern ultra-processed foods that most of us consume daily. The big difference was the oleomargarine still contained expensive animal fats. It wasn't until breakthroughs in industrial chemistry in the early 20th century that we worked out how to make solid fats from cheap liquid oils, often from plants. Or, as it turned out, from the waste materials factories churned out. So how did we make food from our industrial waste? This is cottonseed. To most 19th century industrialists, it was just a waste product produced by the cotton industry. Its oil tasted horrible and contained a toxin that caused infertility in men. But the seeds were abundant, and at that point just being released into the waterways that powered the cotton mills. So, candlemaker William Proctor partnered with his brother-in-law and soapmaker James Gamble and seized the opportunity to reduce the cost of soap and candle production by using cottonseed oil. By 1907, P&G found a way to make this toxic cottonseed oil edible. And so Crisco was born. Fake lard made from detoxified cottonseed. The solution was an elaborate process known as RBD, refined, bleached, deodorized. It's a process that renders even the most colorful, bitter, and toxic oils uniform and bland and therefore usable in just about everything. This issue of popular science from the era sums up the evolution of cottonseed nicely. What was garbage in 1860 was fertilizer in 1870, cattle food in 1880, and table food and many things else in 1890. But the RBD process didn't get rid of all of cottonseed's problems. Crisco was 50% trans fat, a type of unsaturated fat of which the risks were not understood until the 1990s. Trans fat is thought to be responsible for an estimated 500,000 premature deaths globally from cardiovascular disease every year. And in 2018, the World Health Organization issued an unprecedented appeal, asking countries to remove trans fats from the entire food supply. The 19th century was full of waste innovation. Hitler granted Arthur Imhausen, a chemist of Jewish heritage, Aryan status, after he created butter from the coal byproduct paraffin, which these days is burned as fuel. This chemist, Konstantin Fahlberg, discovered saccharin, the first artificial sweetener, during experiments with coal tar, a byproduct of the coal burning process. Occupational exposure to coal tar is known to increase the risk of a number of cancers. Saccharin was added to diets on a large scale following sugar shortages caused by World War I, and is still used in some sweeteners today. Saccharin was linked to cancer in rats, but further studies found that it did not have the same effect in humans, and the FDA have declared it safe for human consumption. But surely this is all ancient history, and modern day regulation is protecting us from harmful chemicals in our food, right? To help support us and to keep up to date with everything we have coming up, don't forget to subscribe. In the US, where 60% of the average adult's diet consists of UPF, there are no legal rules for what tests food companies have to do on the additives they include in their recipes. The process is essentially entirely voluntary, thanks to a loophole that means substances are classed as GRAS, generally recognised as safe, which means they bypass the FDA's pre-market review process. In order to do this, you have to submit an application to the FDA with a bit of data and hope that they add you to the GRAS list. But as the backlog of GRAS applications built up, companies decided to make their own safety decisions in secret without telling the FDA. And by 1997, the FDA decided it was legally fine for companies to do that. How many substances have been self-determined to be GRAS is unknown, because companies are not obliged to tell the FDA. What we do know is that from 2000 to 2023, there were only 10 applications to the FDA for full approval of a new substance, while there were 766 new chemicals added to the food supply chain. That means 756 have been classified as safe by the companies who make them. So you won't know if the corn oil that's on the ingredients list on the back of your chips has been produced using unlicensed additives, because it will just read corn oil.
What you're looking at here is the aftermath of a drumstick ice cream cone that has been sitting out for 22 hours now.
The European Food Standards Agency has more regulation than the US and proactively reviews additives, but there are still a lot of gaps in testing. Because industrial food production only really took off in the last century, the long-term effects of consuming many ingredients are still largely unknown. However, the rise in UPFs has been linked to many chronic health conditions like heart disease, cancer, type 2 diabetes, adverse mental health, and early death. And we are not all exposed to these harms to the same degree. Those with the least money are often forced to buy the cheapest products, which tend to contain additive-laden UPF. While a small number of very wealthy players in big food continue to profit at the expense of marginalised individuals, a gap that is only set to widen. Thank you so much for watching, and if you haven't already, don't forget to subscribe to keep up to date with what we're up to. It's Complicated is a new channel powered by Guardian Journalism, and we want to help make some of the big stories and global events a little bit easier to understand by providing you with clarity and context where we can, and presenting underrepresented stories from around the world. And we'd love to hear from you as well, so let us know what you'd like us to cover in the comments and community tab, and we'll see you next time.